are a country founded on the very noble idea that all men were created equal. Yet for most of the life of this republic, we have treated black people as inferior, and for most of the life of baseball in this country, we have excluded black Americans.
These are days of segregation. You couldn't go and do anything. You couldn't go anywhere. You had certain places you could stay. And so our traveling was in quite a few ways limited, and our entertainment was limited.
At a time when separate but equal was an accepted part of everyday life, there was at least one place where separate was far from equal.
To give you an idea of what we were missing in baseball, blacks won the MVP in the National League 9 out of the next 11 years. So baseball was missing the best players who ever played the game.
In Chattanooga, one of those MVPs would cut his teeth at an early age. In 1947, at the ripe old age of 16, Willie Mays began his professional baseball career playing outfield for the Chattanooga Black Choo Choos.
He was the youngest player on the team. But the reason he was on the team is because he had such outstanding skills then. You could see it then. He was very gifted.
Harold Shepard's father, Beck, owned the Choo Choos from 1947 to 1951. His prize signee? The 16-year-old phenom from Fairfield, Alabama.
The story goes that Mr. Shepard, Beck Shepard, discovered Willie Mays playing in a cow pasture down in Alabama and convinced his mother to allow him to become custodial guardian. And he allowed Willie to come back to Chattanooga and live with him, and he took care of him and looked after him. And before he was 16 years old, he was playing center field for the Chattanooga Black Choo Choos.
Young Harold, just a teenager himself at the time, was the team's bat boy and would room with Mays on road trips.
My dad didn't want us being around the older men too often, too much, because we would learn bad habits. When we would go to a town, he and I would go to a movie, whereas the other players would go to, say, nightclubs or what have you.
Mays was not the only future Hall of Famer to play in Chattanooga. In 1926, Satchel Paige made his professional pitching debut here. He would pitch here until the Birmingham Barons purchased his contract. He would later become the highest paid player in all of baseball. And he was the first Negro League player to be inducted into the Baseball Hall of Fame.
He was playing for the Chattanooga White Sox, which later became known as the Chattanooga Black Lookouts, who played down at Lincoln Park. But he was only here for part of the 26th season and into 27 before he was shipped off to the Black Barons in Birmingham, which is also the same team that when Willie Mays played here 20 years later in 46, he was also eventually sold to the Black Barons.
Despite all the talent in the Negro League, the issue really was black and white. While the Chattanooga Lookouts played at the state-of-the-art Ingalls Stadium, the Chattanooga Black Lookouts and Black Choo Choos played at the much humbler Lincoln Park. And while the Negro League ball players were certainly aware of their second-class status, they were just happy to be playing baseball.
World of difference, world of difference. Ingalls Stadium was part of the Southern League where the Chattanooga Lookouts played. Like I say, these are days of segregation. And that was the only park large enough and halfway decent enough to accommodate sporting events. At that time, people just enjoyed baseball. I'm speaking from the black perspective. They just wanted to attend a good baseball game.
Even then, the time for change was not far off. Jackie Robinson had signed a minor league contract with the Dodgers 2 years earlier in 1945 and made his major league debut that season. Just 1 year later, the top Negro League, the Negro National League, closed its doors. And by 1960, all Negro Leagues, major and minor, had closed up shop.
When Jackie made the majors in 1947, that signaled the demise of the old Negro Leagues. And soon after, all of your white Major League teams began to open their doors to the outstanding, cream of the crop black players. And there were quite a few.
The Chattanooga teams, like most others, only lasted until the mid-50s. But during their time, they were a source of pride and inspiration for black neighborhoods in the area.
Baseball is America's greatest pastime, and everybody loved baseball. And men would bring their wives to the Sunday games, and it was just an afternoon out, more or less kind of a picnic-like atmosphere, and people just loved it.